is between two rigid supports. If you take one rod and here it is uniformly heated, and then without bending, if you increase its temperature of the rod, what will be the thermal stress and what will be the thermal force? If I ask, I think you know it, which is equals to y alpha delta t. Okay. Suppose instead of one rod, if I take two rods like this of same uniform cross section. It's like the same rod is made of two materials, like here. Of lengths L1 and L2, and their linear coefficients of expansions are alpha 1 and alpha 2, and their ends moduli are y1 and y2, and temperature is increased by some T degrees Celsius. This is T is not final temperature, change in temperature is some T degrees Celsius. Then, if I ask, suppose at the junction, without separating, means while heating, the rods are not coming like this between the two supports. Means they are not displacing from each other. Okay, they are not bending. And here, without bending like this, okay, and without separating at the junction, the rod is uniform, means the two rods are uniformly, sorry, here it is alpha. The two rods are uniformly heated. Then what will be the displacement of junction and what is the thermal stress at the junction? If I ask, coming to this concept, suppose if I ask what will be the displacement of the rod and what will be the thermal stress instead of one rod, if I take two rods here, then what he is saying here in the first model, or two rods model, or three rods, many rods, if you take, there, the concept basically is the rod is not bending. He is clearly mentioning in the question. Rod is not bending means actually the length of the rod before heating and after heating remains same. Okay. So logically, if you think, while heating the rod, the length of the rod should be increased, no doubt. What will be the increase in length according to the formula of alpha is equals to delta L into delta T? So we can say the increase in length delta L is equals to L alpha delta T. This is the increase in length. So the length of the rod, suppose say, from 10 meters to 10.01 meters increased, that increase here it can't show, the rod can't show in the rod. Okay? Means in the rod we can't see the expansion, which is delta L is equals to 0.01 meter, we can't see. Okay? Then what happened to 0.01, sir? If you see here, that expansion, since it is rigidly fixed between two supports, okay, is balanced by the compression produced by the two walls here. Means when it tries to expand, the walls are not allowing and tries to compress the rod. Okay, that compression by the walls, by applying some force from the two ends. Okay, like this, by the force. That compression you will get from the formula y is equals to FL by AE. So E is equals to FL by AY. So simple logic. If due to the raise of temperature, you get 0.01 meter of expansion. Okay, due to the thermal stress, you should get the same compression in the rod. Then the length will not be changed, total length. Okay, this is the basic concept. So when a rod is fixed between two supports and the length is not changing, it is not bending, means we have to use all the times delta L is equals to E. Okay. From there only we got this formula, thermal stress, by equating delta L, L alpha delta T to FL by KY. You got F by A is equals to, finally you got that equation. If you keep delta L equals to E, E means FL by KY. Is equals to L alpha delta T. Here it is clearly saying the thermal stress is independent of the length, and F by A you are getting finally by taking the cross multiplication by alpha delta T. Okay. The same basic concept here I am going to use now. Means instead of one rod, how many rods I am taking here? Two rods. Two rods means both the rods will try to expand. So the total expansion in the two rods means delta L1 in the first rod plus delta L2 in the second rod should be equal to, should be equal to the compression due to the thermal stress. Okay, the compression means here between, in the first rod the compression here between these two points, some compression, and again between these two points some compression. So total compression in the rod E1 plus E2. Okay. So basically we have to apply this formula. Okay. And we have to understand. Suppose alpha 1 is greater than alpha 2. Compared to the second rod, the first rod tries to expand quickly. Why? Because I am considering alpha 1 is greater than alpha 2. Means first of all, the first rod tries to push the other rod in this direction. Okay, this indirectly applying some stress. Okay, so here in that case, it is also heated, so it tries to push the first rod in the direction. But compared to, due to the raise of temperature, here it is quickly expanding and that is slowly expanding. So surely here the junction will be displaced to some other position here. Okay, what I am saying, total elongation in the two rods should be balanced by total compression. That doesn't mean, like it is suppose elongation in the first rod is say some 6 millimeters. In the first, second rod it will be some 4 millimeters. Okay, so suppose the compression in the first rod is say some 2 millimeters and the compression in the second rod is 8 millimeters, total will be same, 6 plus 4 is equals to 10, 2 plus 8 equals to 10. But look at the first rod, see here, due to the raise of temperature the elongation will be 6. But due to the compression, means the junction suppose moved to here, okay, the compression is not 6. What I am saying, the compression is not 6 means the compression is just 2 only. So in the first rod is suppose elongated to here, the compression is just 2 meters, means this is the compression. So that all together the rod will appear like this, which one, the first rod. Okay. And in the same way, if you come to the second rod here, suppose elongated by 4, okay, the junction comes from here to there due to the elongation. Okay, but compression will be 8. Compression will be 8 means it won't come back to this position. What I'm saying, the compression will be 8 means it will be compressed more and all together it will come to here. So finally, the rod will be appeared till here the first rod and till there it is the second rod. Okay, so it is the initial position and it is the final position. So here, whatever you are taking the junction between the two rods is displaced from here to there. It is the junction pulse. Okay, it is the junction. So that displacement I am asking, and number two, thermal stress. Okay. So my question is here, while the junction comes from here to there and comes to one equilibrium at that position, further it is neither compressing nor elongating. Like this means neither the junction moves towards right or left. Okay. So finally, after raising the temperature by T degrees, the junction comes to this position and stops there. Stops there means the thermal stress from one side, means thermal force from one side, should be equal to the thermal force from the other side. Okay, means the forces are equal. Net force on the junction is becoming zero. That's why the junction comes to there and stops. Okay. So here basically we have to solve like what, since I am taking the areas of cross section same, here the F1, okay, on the second rod should be equal to the force on the first rod by the second. Okay, so here this is F12 and it is F21, both are equal. Since areas of cross sections are equal, so divided by A if you take, you can equate the thermal stresses of both. Okay, so any thermal stress you can find, means either F12 by A or F2 by A. So thermal stress, let it be, I am taking. Thermal force or thermal stress, let it be F. So thermal stress will be F by A. Okay, this is my assumption. So here the question is, that thermal force if I ask, or the displacement if I ask, or the thermal stress if I ask, how to solve the question, sir? Very simple, we have the fundamental formula, total elongation is equals to total compression, okay, from the first one rod, and this is for two rods. So total elongation here from this concept, I will take in the first rod, elongation formula is L alpha delta t. So I write L1 alpha 1 delta t plus the delta t also I took it as t. So this is the change in temperature. So while solving the problems, substitute not the final temperature. So t is the final change in temperature. And delta L2 will be L2 alpha 2 into change in temperature. I'm taking it as t is equals to here E1. E formula is FL by KY. So no need to write F1. Why? Because after coming to one equilibrium position, forces from both the sides are equal. I am assuming let it be F. Okay. So F in the first rod, E1, L1 by areas I am taking same, area of cross section of the two rods same I am taking here. So A same divided by Y1 in the first rod plus here I am getting F L2 by A Y2 in the second. So either thermal force or thermal stress, if I take common, I will get the answer now. Here T common L1 L alpha 1 plus L2 alpha 2 divided by F by A by taking common. Bring the terms to the left hand side. L1 by Y1 plus L2 by Y2. This is thermal stress. If they are thermal force, cross multiply the area. That's it. Over. So you will get from this equation both thermal stress and thermal force. Okay. Then here, what is the displacement means? In the explanation I told. Okay. Suppose it is the final length of the rod due to the elongation. Okay. And it is the compression. Okay. Then here the displacement you can find the elongation minus compression gives the displacement of the rod. Okay, that is simply from this equation you can say the displacement of the rod is either delta L1 minus E1 or delta L2 minus E2 or E2 minus delta L2. Okay, so here the displacement, okay, let it be displacement of junction, okay, is displacement, okay, final length minus compression, okay, so displacement of junction, let it be x, is equals to what I have to write L2 minus L1, that is delta L1, okay, minus E1, okay, or you can write mod of E2 where delta L2 minus E2, anyone you can take, okay. So here the displacement, why I put mod at that, maybe towards right or towards left, we are not taking any sign conventions, okay, just I am asking the displacement, I am not asking whether it moves towards right or left. So I took here mod, okay. So in this case delta L1 minus E1 means delta L1 is L1 alpha 1 into t, that implies x is equals to L1 alpha 1 into t minus E1, E1 is equals to F by A. This F by A we have to substitute. F by A, okay, into L1 by Y1. Okay, so when you come to numericals, this F by A find out and substitute there and try to find out the displacement. Or you can write X is equals to mod of delta L2 minus E2 is L2 alpha 2 into T minus E2. E2 means again F by A into L2 by Y2. Okay, right. This is the story now. Okay. So related to this concept, previously he asked the questions on are related. Okay. Suppose if I give one question like what he gave in the exam, he gave in exam at the junction, he took the two lengths are equal. Okay. Previously given. And here the alpha 1 and y 1 are given as alpha and y 1 only. Okay. And suppose the junction does not shift, what he asked. Junction does not shift means what he is saying. Junction after heating this rod uniformly, the junction will be here only. It is neither moving towards right nor moving towards left. Junction is there means indirectly previously given in exam, given x is equals to 0, there is no displacement to the junction. Okay. And simply he is asking what will be the relation between alpha and y. Very simple. So x is equals to 0 means what can I write? L1 alpha 1 into t equals to, these two are equal. Why? Because x is equals to 0, equals to f by a into L1 by Y1. He said L1 is equals to L2, let it be L. Means these lengths are equal. L1 is equals to L2. So here you can cancel L1, L1 here. So alpha 1 into T is equals to F by A. Okay. F by A is equals to T into L1 is equal to L2. So L also common. Alpha 1 plus alpha 2 into L, L common, divided by what? L1 by Y1, L by Y1 plus L by Y2, L common, 1 by Y1 plus 1 by Y2, this is F by A, by Y1, by Y. Okay, then you can get some relation between what, here LL also cancel, very simple, no? Alpha 1, Y1, into Y1 plus Y2 by Y1, Y2 equals to alpha 1 plus alpha. So here Y1, Y1 cancel. You are getting some relation between alphas and Ys there. Understood, Nana? This is one model. Okay. Related to what? The displacement of a junction. Right? Suppose, Nana, here these are two rods placed, okay, of same length, L and L, okay, but the linear coefficients of expansions are alpha 1 and alpha 2, okay, and here this is one more rod, and he is not saying it is equilateral triangle, this is one triangle, that's it, okay, you can say isosceles, why, because he gave these two lengths are equal, right, and this is of another material, alpha 3, okay. Right? Here its length say some L2. Okay, better take them as L1. Okay, and here by putting this one at one fixed position on a horizontal pole and like this. Okay, three rods are placed on the pond and this position is fixed. Okay, if the system is heated, what will be the shift of the vertex? Okay, so here what will be the shift means simple. Here before expanding you can say it is the height of the triangle. Okay, so that one, that height before heating is equals to, let it be initial height h1. Okay, from mathematics you can say root of here l1 square minus, this is half of the length. Why? Because isosceles. So it is l2 by 2 whole square. This is initial height. Okay, final height means here in this case, after heating the system uniformly, delta T is equal to some T degrees Celsius, raising temperature. It is fixed on that line. So suppose here from this position to some other position, it is expanded like this. Okay, initial length L2, this will be L2 dash, means final length of the first rod. But final length, you can say the formula is equals to initial length into 1 plus alpha delta t. I think you know this formula. Final length is equals to, like, suppose initial length is L, final length is L dash. L dash is equals to L into 1 plus alpha delta t. Okay. From that formula, here L2 dash, the final length, I write like L2 into 1 plus alpha is alpha 3 into delta t. Delta T, he gave it here as T. Okay. From that, try to find out in the numerical L2 dash. And here, suppose this length obviously increases. Why? Because it is not fixed. So increases. Increases means maybe move to there. And this length also increases, maybe move to some other position. Okay. So here suppose after increasing, okay, and here the problem is if it is not fixed, the length of final length of this rod may not be equal to the final length of the third rod. So means the second rod here. Okay. So finally they may not form one vertex at the end. That's why when you come to numericals, generally what they do, to bring to this position means uniformly heating both are, means the final lengths should be equal, not like this. Okay, generally what they give, their alphas equal. Alphas equal means suppose alpha 2 also, if you take it as alpha 1 to avoid this situation. Okay, so here both will get the same length, final length, like L1 dash and L1 dash. Okay, with alpha 1 and alpha 1. Then no need to consider it as alpha 3, you may take it as alpha 2. So here I change, it is alpha 2. Okay. Now here in this case, the height, again it is isosceles triangle. Okay. To avoid such type of conditions, what I erase it. So here this h dash, again you can calculate, h dash is equals to height of the vertex, equals to, what this is L1 dash whole square minus L2 dash by 2 whole square under root. Okay, this is L2 dash by 2, this part is. So here what he is asking, previously the vertex is here, now due to the heat, it may come to this position like, what will be the displacement of vertex? Means what he is asking, from this position to that position, it moved. Previously it is here, now it is there. So what is the displacement of vertex? So simple, you know, h dash minus h. That implies displacement x is equals to, in the numericals try to solve it as h dash minus h. Okay, So here, to get such type of case, we have to assume and he has to give these two alphas are equal. Okay, this is one model related to linear expansion of solids. Okay, and suppose if the material is isotropic. Isotropic means try to understand, expands uniformly in all directions. Okay, suppose this is one thin rod whose area of cross section is in the shape of a rectangle. Means compared to length, area of cross section is small, where the area of cross section is a rectangle like this. This is the area of cross section, a rectangle. And here generally, what will be the final length if I ask? Directly we write L2 dash equals to L into 1 plus alpha delta. Okay. Means we are considering for the rod in any direction like this or like this downwards or like this inwards, x, y, z, any direction, it is expanding uniformly. That is isotropic substance. If it is given as an anisotropic substance, then how to write that formula? It is an anisotropic substance if the material is anisotropic substance. Then here, if the metal is not isotropic substance, then here Nana, we have to take that alpha in all the three directions. Okay, means the L dash in the lengthwise, the B dash in the breadthwise, the H dash in the heightwise, and we have to take what that final volume as initial volume as LBH, final volume as L dash, B dash, H dash, and finally trying to write that equation in terms of LBH. Finally, while writing, this is actually volume. Okay, volume means volume coefficient of expansion is gamma. You will get while writing this part as, here while writing simple, nana, 1 plus alpha 1 delta t along the lengthwise into b dash means 1 plus alpha 2 delta t. This is L into b. This is L dash b dash. H dash is h into 1 plus alpha 3 delta t in three directions, x axis, y axis, z axis. Okay. Then final volume is L dash, B dash, H dash. That I will get like L, B, H into this whole thing I will get. Okay. That whole thing is 1 plus alpha 1 delta T into 1 plus alpha 2 delta T into 1 plus alpha 3 delta T. Okay. While expanding that term, Nana, here 1 you will get. Okay. Next what you will get? Alpha 2 delta T 1 into plus alpha 3 delta t. Okay. So with 1 I multiply. With 1 I multiply now. Okay. Next with alpha 1, I think you are following. 1 into 1, 1. Okay. 1 into alpha 2 delta t. Again 1 into 1, 1. 1 into alpha 3 delta t. Part over. Again here alpha 1 delta t. Okay. Plus later terms, you see, Nana, alpha 1, alpha 2, delta t, plus again alpha 1, delta t, you will get. Okay. And here alpha 1 into alpha 2, I am neglecting, Nana. Why? Because alpha is very small, actually in the order of 10 power minus 6. So alpha 1 into alpha 2, if you take it, is in the order of 10 power minus 12, very small. That's why alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 2, alpha 3, alpha 3, alpha 1 terms I am neglecting. So likewise, if you expand this term, you will get, Nana, here finally 3 times 2 alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha 3 into delta t you will get. Okay. So this is appeared like what? Here also you will get 3, Nana. If you take 3 common, finally you will get here after expanding 1 plus alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha 3 into delta t. Look at here, Nana. You are getting, it is appeared like final volume is equals to initial volume into 1 plus, actually we write gamma delta t. So gamma is appeared like alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha 3. Okay. If it is isotropic substance, we take all alpha in all directions same, and we write gamma is equal to alpha plus alpha plus alpha, which is 3 alpha, we write. Okay, for isotropic substance. That we know, gamma is equals to 3 alpha straight away, for isotropic. For anisotropic substance, if you come, gamma is equals to alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha 3. Then he is asking for anisotropic substance, what will be the alpha, means mean alpha is asked. So that one, from the two equations I write, that implies mean alpha, 3 alpha is equals to alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha 3. Therefore, alpha can be written as alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha 3 by 3. Okay. So if they give an anisotropic substance, Nana, to find out the final length, you can use this alpha term there. Okay. I think you can say, in the same, using the same logic, if I ask the relation between gamma, beta and alpha, there you write beta means only area. So I have to write beta is equals to either alpha 1 plus alpha 2 in one particular area in cuboid. Okay. Suppose for this area, and for the other area, I can write alpha 2 plus alpha 3. Okay, so first area over, second area over, top or bottom area, I can write alpha 1 plus alpha, beta equals. Okay, so there you can write here beta in terms of any two and gamma equals to in terms of all the three, alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha 3. Okay, this is for anisotropic substance now, right? And then here in the same expansions of solids, suppose here this is one wooden wheel, bullock cart wheel, okay, in villages. Okay, this is the wheel. Generally we see in villages this type of wheel. Okay, and here for that wheel, generally they fix one iron ring at the top. This is one iron. Okay. While fixing the total procedure, you know, no need to explain. Why? Because you know, in many basic models, very simple. So suppose the wheel radius is RW and iron ring radius is say RI. Okay. Initially, we take ring radius is less than the wheel radius. That's why if you try to slip over the wheel, it won't slip. Why? Because lesser than the radius of wheel. So generally, we uniformly heat from all sides and we try to expand the area. Okay, from Ri to Ri dash. And that Ri dash is suppose equals to Rw, radius of the wheel after heat. Then we try to slip over the surface, okay, and then not to come out, we try to pour the water from all sides and try to cool that iron ring, heated ring. Then immediately it tries to press the wheel from all sides and fix it to the wheel. This is the process. I think you know it. In this case, what will be the raise of temperature, minimum raise of temperature, just to slip over the surface? I think you know. Okay, it is related to the radius part, Nana. Means the perimeter of the wheel you are increasing from Ri to Ri dash. So it is related to length concept. Alpha is equals to L2 minus L1 by L1 into delta t. Okay, L2 minus L1 means the final length is 2 pi Ri dash, which is equals to Rw, minus initial length of this wheel, iron ring is equals to 2 pi Ri. 2 pi Rl into delta. Okay. From here, you can say alpha is equals, just like L2 minus L1, Rw minus Ra by L1 Ra into eta. From here, you can find what will be the increase in temperature. No need to explain. I think you know this concept. Okay. From this concept, here, suppose if I ask one question. What, instead of wheel, actually we take one circular wheel. Instead of one circular wheel, if I take here two semicircular wheels, okay, this is one semicircular wheel and it is another semicircular wheel. I want to join them and here place one iron ring over it. Okay. So in that model, if I ask to fix these two semicircular wheels, okay, inside iron ring, what will be the raise in temperature? There is no fault manner. Here and there, there is no difference. Straight away, you can say the raise in temperature from the formula. You can say, suppose this is the radius. This is the initial radius of the ring. You can say delta T is equal to this much star over. Okay. But here, suppose if I ask, look at here, Nana, actually radius of ring is less than the radius of wheel. Okay, lesser by a few millimeters. Okay, so while cooling, actually rings is supposed to come to this position, Nana, actually. Okay, why? Because radius of ring is less than the radius of wheel. Supposed to come to that position means it tries to press the wheel from all sides and can't come to this position. Why? Because it is placed over the wheel. Okay. Over the wheel means while trying to compress to the original radius, it tries to apply the force from all sides. That force per unit area of cross section is called as again thermal stress. In heat chapter, that is called as thermal stress. Okay. So here, is suppose asking what is the force acting on each part of semicircular ring. Okay. There, very simple, Nana, if you are able to find out the tension in the two parts, okay, using what again the thermal stress is equals to Y alpha delta T and thermal force is equals to that much. Okay, means if they ask this question, there is a chance to do in a wrong way. Question is appeared to be very easy. Okay, here the thermal stress means F by A is equals to sir Y alpha delta T, sir. So directly thermal force acting on each part is equals to Y alpha delta T into area, sir. They will give all the values here, the area of cross section of each part also they will give. Suppose it is a circular part, area of cross section of each part also they give here and there. So we can say the answer as yes, sir. But problem is, it is not the answer. Okay? Why? Because here, this is one semicircular part and it is another semicircular part. Here, while joining, it is in contact at two ends here now. Okay? In contact means that each contact, it is trying to apply some force and it creates the stress. Stress at not one end, stress on two ends. Means here, if you see, this is the second part. By the first part, here it applies some force, there also it applies some force. Okay, that force per unit area you told it as thermal stress. From that, each force you calculated here F, there F. Okay. So look at what is the force acting on each semicircular part means the force on semicircular part is not F. The answer is equals to, I have to say 2F. Okay. 2 into Y alpha delta T into A is the answer. Okay. So it is the basic concept. Related to the basic concept, he extended the question with two semicircular parts. Okay. Why he gives semicircles, or why don't he give one quadrant and 3/4 quadrant like this, sir? In a circle, suppose this is one part of the wheel and this is another part of the wheel. Why don't they give like this, sir? Yes, they can give. Problem is, compared to this one, that is complicated. Why? Here the advantage is, look at the two ends, the forces are acting in the same direction. That's why straight away he told the answer, force acting on the semicircular part is F and F, same direction, also 2F from the first part. But here look at Nana. Here, by the first part, suppose if you see, this is the first part and this is the second part. What is the force acting on the second part, if I ask? Okay, while fixing this ring over the wheel, one is quadrant, other is 3/4 quadrant. Okay. In this case, the disadvantage here is the force acting on the first side of second part here, it will be in this direction. Okay. And that force, look at here, it is independent of length. Nah. So independent of length, no problem at all. Y alpha delta t into area of cross section. Here and there, uniform cross sectional wheel, that is. So there the force is F. Here on the second part, okay, second end of second part, the force will be in this direction. Okay, so look at the two forces are not in the same direction. Luckily, it is quadrant and other is 3/4 quadrant means. Here the force is acting in this direction. Here the force is acting in the direction. Both are appeared like perpendicular. Perpendicular means the resultant force will act according to parallelogram law of vectors here. The resultant will act in this direction, which is, since the forces are equal, bisector, the total angle will be bisector. So exactly the force will act in this direction. That force answer is equals to, I have to write root 2. Okay. So even though this is previously given question, Nana. Okay. Here the two parts, one part applies how much force on the second part, not the thermal force. So we have to understand the question properly. He is not asking thermal force. What is the force applied by the first part on the second part? Okay. It is easy. Suppose in 2020, in July, if they ask this type of model, you can solve it. Okay. Keep in mind, here the angle between these two forces is nothing but the angle of this quadrant. Okay, you may ask wisely here, sir, that is not given like one quadrant, sir, in exam. Suppose if they give like an arc, sir. Okay, like an arc, sir, this is the second part of wheel, sir. Then very simple, here one force will act in this direction, other force will act another direction, and the angle between these two forces is equal to the angle subtended by this part. Okay, if the angle be subtended by the first part is theta at the center, then you can say according to parallelogram law of vectors, F means answer, net force on the second part, you can say, which is equals to root of F square plus F square plus 2F, and the angle between these two is cos theta. Cos theta, you can write. Straight away, you can solve the answer. Okay. So, the same model, even though they extend to any type, you can solve such type of questions. Okay. Right. This is one more model in the expansions of solids. Okay. And here, I strongly believe you know about the bimetal strip. Suppose this is one rod, okay, of length some L. Say some length of rod is 30 centimeters, better you think. And its linear coefficient of is some alpha 1, okay. And its length, I am measuring with a scale. Okay, suppose for my convenience, I am taking the length of scale as 30 centimeters. Okay, and the scale is made at a temperature of say some 0 degrees Celsius. So I think you can understand here, this is the scale number. Okay, so here, If I measure the length of any rod with this scale at 0 degrees Celsius, I will get the perfect readings without any errors. Okay, but the problem is there is no guarantee that I measure the lengths of some part of room or the rod here always measure at 0 degrees Celsius. I may measure at 20 degrees Celsius. I may measure at 25 degrees Celsius. I may measure in summer season 45 degrees Celsius. So problem is while measuring, the length of the scale also changes and the length of the rod is also changes. That is the problem. So when you come to, when the temperature is changed to, okay, some say 30 degrees Celsius, okay, then what will be the measurement of the rod and what will be the actual length of the rod, okay? So here problem is change to 30 degrees Celsius means the rod first expands. This is rod nana. Okay. Original length is 30 centimeters. This is the original length. Okay. And here this is suppose the expansion of the rod. Okay. Which is delta L1. Expansion of the rod. That you can find out nana. Taking this as initial length. L1 alpha 1 into. Okay, and here the scale, okay, for my convenience, how much I took, this is also of length 30 centimeters, okay, here it is also 30 centimeters scale, and its initial length is equals to L2 equals to, it is not final length, L2 means length of second material, L2 is equals to 30 centimeters, and its linear coefficient of expansion is alpha. Okay, suppose if I consider the linear coefficient of rod is greater than the linear coefficient of expansion of scale, means rod is quickly expanding more, but the scale is slowly expanding and expands less. Alpha 2 is less. So the scale, final 30th division, it is the final division, 30th division. May come to somewhere here. This is shifted to here. Okay. Appear like this is the 30 centimeters. Actually, that is not 30 centimeters scale. Only this part is 30 centimeters. Due to expansion, 30th division shifts to there. Okay. Look at this expansion is delta L2 is equals to, I can write, using the same formula, L alpha delta T, L2 length of this one, alpha 2 into delta T. Okay? So here, the measurement is appeared. What we take? This is 30, means I measured till here as 30. Okay? Plus something I say, what the final length of the rod. Okay? So final length of the rod with the scale, I measure it as till here 30 with the scale, okay, plus some part, means L1 dash, okay, the final length of the rod means what I have to write L1, okay, plus delta L1, that is L1 alpha 1 delta T. Actually, this is the final length at what temperature? 30 degrees. Okay, that I know. This is the final. But the scale how measures how much? Scale till here it measures as 30. 30 means its length. Okay, so till here 30, this L2 L1 dash is appeared like L2 till here 30. Plus, again, the same scale should be placed here like this. Okay. Plus some other part it will give. So, plus something means that is how much, look at here. The delta L1 minus delta L2 is the extra part. Okay. Are you following, Nana? Simple. Till here it is originally 30. Scale expands up to here. But rod expands up to here. That's why scale says it is the 30th division. So extra with the scale we have to measure. That extra part is nothing but expansion in the rod minus expansion in the scale. This is the expansion in the scale and it is the expansion in the rod. So extra part I require. So L2 dash, it says, okay, till here, plus L2 plus the remaining part is delta L1 minus delta L2 is equals to L1 dash. So L1 dash, look at here, Nana. Here, suppose this is actually what L1 plus delta L1. So here that L1 dash is equals to this one means if I substitute there L2 dash, sorry, this is what L2 plus delta L1 minus delta L2 is equals to L1 dash is L1 plus delta L1. Look at here, Nana, delta L1 cancel. So here the error in the measurement delta L2 is appeared like L2 minus L1. Okay, look at here. L2 is what? L1 is what? Okay, L2 is after expanding the length. Okay, L1 is before expanding the length. Okay, so take care here. I am taking till here as L2 after expanding. Okay. So understood, Nana? That one, if you substitute there, means to understand very easily here, what will be the error in the measurement if they ask? Very simple, you can say what I said, delta L1 minus delta L2. So error is equals to, I am writing here, delta L1 minus this part, delta L1 minus delta L2. Okay? And here sometimes in the exam, if they give alpha 2 is greater than alpha 1. Alpha 2 is greater than alpha 1 means scale is expanding quickly. Okay. The 30th, this is the original length of the scale. Means this is the original length of the rod. And it is the 30th division of my exam, in my example. That one shifted to here, 30th division. Means this is the expansion in the scale. In the scale means it is taken as alpha 2. Alpha 2 means delta L2. But rod is slowly expanding. May come to here. Come to here means it is not even showing 30 centimeters. Okay. So error is equals to how much? In this case, look at Nana. Delta L1 is greater than delta L2. Sorry, delta L2 is greater than delta L1. So in this case, error is equals to, I have to write delta L2 minus delta L1 since the alpha 2 is greater than alpha. Okay. And here, what will be the reading of scale means? If alpha 2 is greater than alpha 1, look at here. It says the length of the rod as not even 30. It may be on the scale after expanding. This is the final length of the scale after expanding. It is the 30th division. Means it may be some 28th division or 29th division or 27th division. So what my intention is, scale reads the length of rod as, okay, less than 30 centimeters when scale expands more. Okay, look at here. If the rod expands more, it will measure, the scale measures the length of rod as, okay, greater than 30 centimeters, greater than the original length. Okay, so that is, when the rod expands more, scale reads more than the original length. The scale reading will be more than the original length. If scale linear coefficient of expansion more, means scale expands more, the reading will be less than the original length. Okay. How much? Less than by how much? If they ask, very simple. 30 centimeters instead of that it is showing 28 means we have to subtract this part. That is the error, huh? So the reading will be how much in this case if they ask. Reading is equals to, I say the 30 centimeters, what is the original length? Okay, 30 minus this part is how much, Nana? The error, which is delta L2 minus delta L. There, the scale measures how much length you are asking. Scale measures, which is greater than 30 centimeters, means the reading on the scale. Reading at what temperature? At final temperature change to 30 degrees Celsius. At 30 degrees Celsius. Okay, this is also at 30 degrees Celsius. Okay, equals to what I have to say, the scale measures the length as 30 plus error. Okay, this simple logic you have to find, notice now. Okay, if the alpha of rod is more, the final length measured by the scale will be the original length plus error. Whereas if the scale expands more, means linear coefficient of scale is more, then the final reading measured by the scale is equals to original length minus error. Okay, if you follow that logic, any kind of problem here you can solve. Okay, this is one model related to errors in the measurements when scale is also expanding along with the rod. Okay, case, suppose here he said volume of vessel, you take it as some V, okay, or V1, and volume of liquid inside the vessel, you take it as V. Look at, both are not equal. Volume of air remains constant in the vessel means here, while heating this vessel from outside, okay, the base area is increasing, the height of the vessel is also increasing. Means total volume of the vessel in this case increasing. Okay, and the liquid also same, total volume is increasing. But volume of air remains constant at all temperatures. In the three-dimensional vessel, if you see, whatever the vessel is expanding in all three directions, okay, is equals to the expansion of liquid in all the three directions. Means what I am saying, the increase in volume of vessel is equals to the increase in volume of liquid in three dimension, in all the three directions. Okay, then here you can say the volume of air remains constant at all temperatures above the liquid. This is first model. Okay, in this case, what will be the expansion of vessel? Directly I can say delta V is equals to gamma V delta T of vessel. Gamma of vessel means a solid, and volume of vessel he gave it as V1 into delta T, and this of liquid is same. Gamma V delta T, where gamma of liquid is a real expansion, not apparent expansion, the real expansion of liquid into volume of liquid is V2, then you are getting here like gamma V equals to constant, like gamma 1 V1, that is gamma of solid into V1 is equals to gamma 2 V2, gamma of liquid into V2. This is one condition. Same type of condition even you can see in solids also. I think you know that model. When two different rods here having the lengths L1, L2 and the temperature, linear coefficients of expansions alpha and alpha 2, and the difference in their length, initial difference in their length, which is delta L, remains constant even though you expand the two rods like this. Even in that case also, the difference in the final lengths L2 dash minus L1 dash will be same. Okay, if that is the case, then L1 alpha 1 is equals to L2 alpha 2, we write in expansions of solids. Like L alpha is equals to constant in solids, whereas here we can say gamma V is equals to constant. But the second model is little bit tricky, Nana. He's trying to distract us, okay? Trying to solve the model in the same way, like gamma S V1 is equals to gamma R into V2. Okay, but the model is not same, Nana. There, the height remains same means the area means base area of vessel is expanding, okay, but we are not finding out any increase in the height, okay. Means what he is saying, the total base expansion, okay, base expansion means what we have to say, delta A, okay, delta A is equals to the delta A of liquid. Okay, here problem is delta A means generally what we write on A into beta into delta T, but beta is not there for liquid. So what we have to say, delta A is equals to here of solid is equals to delta A of liquid. If you write, anyone will laugh on our face. Okay, why? Because there is no beta for the liquid. That's why what I have to say, delta V of liquid here should be equals to what I have to write, while writing delta V of solid, there I have to take delta V as like V2 minus V1, we write anana, that V2 I write it as A2 into H minus A1 into H, not A2 H2 minus A1 H1. That's what I'm saying. This height remains constant. So this one I write it as A2 minus A1 means delta A into the height means length remains constant is equals to delta V of liquid. Okay, then I think you will get the idea. Okay, if height remains constant, very simple, delta V of liquid means I have to write gamma R into volume of liquid is V2, V2 into delta T. Here also the height of solid also does not change. So here delta A means I have to write beta A base area into delta T into H. Okay, so here this one delta T get cancelled. We are getting beta A into H is equals to gamma R into V2. Okay, that you can write, Nana. Okay, right? Area into H you can write, and gamma R into V2 also you can write. Actually, height of vessel and height of liquid not same. Okay, so here we have to write actually the length of what? The liquid. Length of solid. So it is taken as L. Okay. And here while writing what I have to write, beta A into L, L means the length. Okay. Is equals to, I have to write gamma R into volume is base area into height of the length. So A into H. Then in that case you can say beta L is equals to gamma R into H. Look at these two are not equal. It is in terms, both are in gamma, but that is one in terms of beta, other in terms of gamma. Okay, this is the story, Nana, what he is saying, right? This model, Nana, suppose in that case in liquids, suppose one block is floating at the surface. Here, when you come to the mechanical properties of fluids, generally what we write, mg is equals to fb. Force of buoyancy means the volume present inside into rho of liquid into g. I think you know that formula from mechanical properties of fluids. Okay, the volume present inside this much volume. Okay, which is equals to mg. And here mg again you can write it as density of solid into volume of solid. Okay, density into volume is the mass is equals to V in into rho L. So simple, Nana. The fraction of volume present inside means inside volume divided by the total volume of solid. That is the fraction. Okay, like one third part is submerged, like two third part is submerged means what you are saying, one third part is submerged means in the total volume of V, one third part is submerged. So V in by V simply gives the fraction, how much a fraction is submerged inside. So fraction means how you get here the fraction V in by V. So the fraction of volume present inside is equals to V in by V. Oh, sorry. Which is equals to, from this equation, V in by V is equals to rho S by rho L from that equation. Okay. This is the fraction of volume present inside. Okay. Volume inside the liquid. Okay. That fraction, how it changes when both the solid means the material which is floating and here the liquid is also expanding and neglecting liquid, we have to take in a vessel. So the expansion of vessel I am neglecting. Okay. In that case, fraction means generally what we say, initial fraction is equals to initial density of solid divided by initial density of liquid at some T1 degree Celsius. Okay. Now you are heating that one to a temperature T2. Suppose temperature is increased from T1 degree Celsius to T2 degree Celsius. If I increase, then what happens? If you see here, temperature is increased, problem is density changes. Okay. Temperature is increased. When temperature is increased, volume increases and density decreases. I think all of you know it. Why? Because volume and density are inversely proportional. So here problem is the densities are changing. So fraction F2, what I have to write, density of solid at T2 degrees Celsius divided by density of liquid at T2 degrees Celsius. Then we have to come to know what will be the density at T2, that means the final density. Okay. Generally, we write gamma is equals to V2 minus V1 by V1 into T2 minus T1. That V2 minus V1, if you write mass by density M minus M by rho 1, V2, sorry, M by rho 2 minus V1, M by rho 1 by V1, mass by density M by rho 1 into delta, okay, T2 minus T1. You will get the relation between gamma and density is nothing. Therefore, gamma is equals to, I can write a rho 1 minus rho 2, not rho 2 minus rho 1, by rho 2 into delta t. Okay, from this, if you replace the terms, means cross multiplying and bring it to the other hand, you will get rho 1 is equals to rho 2 into 1 plus gamma delta. Okay, so here, from that equation, rho 1 is equals to rho 2 into 1 plus gamma delta t. Here, I can write in the fraction 1, F1 is equals to rho of solid 1 is equals to rho 2 means rho S2 into 1 plus gamma of solid into delta T divided by, this is rho S1 by rho L1, rho of liquid. Rho of liquid means rho L2 from this equation, rho 2. Into 1 plus gamma. Gamma of liquid is real expansion into delta. Okay. Now you can look the relation between F1 and F2. Straight away I can write rho S2 by rho L2 is nothing but F2. So F1 is equals to fraction, second fraction into 1 plus gamma S delta T by 1 plus gamma R into delta. This is the relation between the fractions of volumes. Okay, in the liquid, right? So in that case, suppose if they ask here, generally liquid expansion is more compared to solid expansion, that all of you know. Compared to again liquid expansion, gaseous expansion will be more. So liquid is expanding more means it tries to sink. Okay, so if they ask neglecting the expansion of solid means coming back to easy model. Okay. In that case, suppose here, if you take it is some part of like initial volume present inside the liquid, V1 inside is equals to what he is saying, was like suppose 1/3 volume of the solid. Okay. At T1 degrees Celsius, means let's say some 20 degrees Celsius. And if you increase the temperature, it tries to sink. Okay, at suppose some 60 degrees Celsius, if the solid is just submerged like this, okay, completely sinks, okay, total volume is just below the surface, comes like this, okay, then V2 inside I have to write is equals to total volume at what temperature? 60 degrees Celsius. Then neglecting the expansion of solid, what will be the real expansion of liquid if they ask? Okay, then in that case how to solve? Saying if only the liquid is expanding, what will be the real expansion? You are saying that one, you are saying like gamma r is equals to like rho 1 minus rho 2 by rho 2 into delta t, that you will get from force of buoyancy. So you know that model. Okay, right here what I am saying, if both solid and liquid are expanding, I will give some relation here now already. Okay, initial fraction V in by V is given as 1 by 3, substitute here. Final fraction, okay, which is V, V means V in by V, V becomes V in by V nana. V in is equals to V, V by V, that is equals to 1, means initial fraction is 1 by 3, final fraction is 1. Why? Because completely submerged. Into the same thing you substitute here and try to find out gamma r. Obviously, they will give gamma s, nana. Gamma s, they will give delta t. Or else, if they ask the relation between gamma s and gamma r, that also you can solve if both are expanding.